It doesn't let off. Okay, so we'll go to the last line on the top section on page Chavtes. I pointed out that by tefillin there are four batim. These four batim represent four moichin, dalet moichin. What is the dalet moichin refer to? Chochmah and binah. And the other two moichin refer to the two other aspects that are contained in moichin, and that is chesed and gevurah. But the chesed and gevurah that is contained in moichin is what's called bebchinas pshitus, which means that is completely embraced by the moichin element, and you don't recognize chesed and gevurah per se. So why four batim? However, in moichin there is a one faculty of moichin that's called das, and das, as we discussed last night, das is where all the possibilities in moichin have finally been identified. But and identified in a manner that now you see that in moichin also there are these four qualities. This is what das is. And therefore we say that in the pshitus, we're not going to go back to explaining the pshitus, in the pshitus of moichin, nonetheless, eine bebchinas pshitus mamosh. It is not in the sense of pshitus mamosh, meaning that there is no identifiable aspect. As we explained, that when it comes to das means that yes, you have an overall sense of the reality, but in this reality, you sense all the ingredients that go into it, as opposed to chochmah, where the ingredients are not sensed, just the overall reality. Therefore, it is not pshitus mamish. Im heyois, although, Shali deze, that as a result of the fact that it's pshitus, yochelius achlifu duchtaihu, there could be the possibility of it being achlifu duchtaihu, that the different qualities of chesed and gevurah should interchange their places. Achlifu duchtaihu is implying that they are not that adamantly identified as chesed and gevurah exclusively. And this is what he's saying, it's not pshitus mamash, even though that as a result of the pshitus it is possible that it should be achlifu duchta. And this inyan, that it is pshitus and not pshitus, which can only be related to through this the mishalim that we brought down, where we actually see both aspects. Where you see the final product, and you see how the final product is rooted in that which is infinitely above. Let us continue further. V'amur v'mizeh, what can be understood from the above? Hu gimul inyonim. There are three inyonim that can be now pointed out from all that we have discussed. Again, last night we had this question. A very valid question. What is the point of all of this for us? How does that affect our thinking? How does that affect our world? So we explained that this is the thought process that allows in the seichel element to recognize the metzius of the world and yet keep it connected to its source. And here's the point which is extremely important. Again, we live in this world that claims to have all the wisdom. And as a result, it completely negates a lakus and a moon and so forth, and seichel, in fact, and a very powerful basis, arguments. And that is, the principle is, even if we say, this is part of that lingo, that yes, the world was created, but once it was created, it stands on its own. It's not real, it doesn't reflect the Creator. I'm not dreaming up this question. This is definitely one of the most powerful presentations of the whole thing. I'm not denying God, but God has no relevance in our world after He created the world. And what this is giving us the ability to see and understand, and what we ought to understand is that the world as a created entity is totally dependent for its own, for its present reality, for the Godly presence. You have these all kinds of mishalim that we had last night and Tuesday. This is what it's about. This is what it's about, even in our lowly world. In fact, I mean, on a higher level, it is clearly of very deep significance. But even on the lowest level, that way, you don't get lost in the labyrinth of the world. Because you recognize how it is all engulfed and embraced by the bigger reality. Abuva Mizahu Gimunyot, what we can understand from the above is three principles. Aleph, one, the ha'oiro is the chesed and gevurah. Now the oiros of chesed and gevurah, kishehein b'hakeilim, when they are actually represented in keilim, mikeilim shalahem, in their keilim, hareihein b'bchines chesed and gevurah mamush, then the oiros have the quality of chesed and gevurah mamosh in real, the dimension of chesed and gevurah. This is a phenomenal statement. What does it mean to us? What does it mean chesed and gevurah mamosh and so on? Oiros. We spoke recently a lot about daylight and light. In daylight, one would not say that the daylight illuminates this house and this house. In light, that is the correct statement. There's an actual focus on illuminating this place and this place. This is when the oiros are in the keilim. What's meaning keilim? Keilim means that you identify the actual phenomenon of the oir. Let me explain it in terms of this muscle. Mentioned last night that from a physical perspective, the way sight is understood in the world, the light is reverberating from the object, and hence the eye. This reverberation from the object, this is like the keili for the eye, for the oir.
What is the keili?
This is like the keili for the oir. Because this is what takes from the oir that ability to illuminate an object. Which one? Which are the keili? So if you're looking at it from the Kelim Mamut, from the Kelim perspective, it is truly a focused oil, and it has an active performance in illuminating this object. Chesed and Gevurah Mamut. In other words, it is not a general statement, it is a specific statement. See this object. Okmei hasvara, as in the case of the svara of Shmai Baftali, the svara, the original svara, which is Oyer Haseichel. Kishehi ba'asogas hilel v'shamai. When this svara comes down and is absorbed by the hasoga, by the comprehension of Hillel and Shammai, harehi bivchinas chesed gvura mamush. There, the svara, the seichel aspect, is bivchinas chesed gvura mamush, as an aspect of chesed gvura. What is a svara? you have to get into, away from the Mesholim, and get into this. What is for? So we have said many times, as an example, the Rebbeister had created the world, and he brought man into the world, and he gave man the ability and the right to maneuver around things in the world to his liking, to his understanding. In matter of speech, this is what we call ownership. When somebody moves things around in his own home, or he moves things around in somebody else's home because he's hired to decorate the house, there's a big difference. When he moves around in his own home, he has every right to do this. This is establishing sin. In other words, in plain talk, a decorator, he has to justify. He says, this looks nice. The owner says, but I want it here. It fits me, I feel better than here. Finished. And he has that capability, he has that right and that power to set it the way he wants it. This right is rooted in the highest crevices on the mind. Where we understand that a human being is a real presence in the world. Not only is he a real presence by right, but by responsibility, by divine mission. So when this principle comes into kelim, what is the kelim for this principle that a human being has the right, has an ownership of the world? Kelim is when he wants to put the object from here to here. This demonstrates and shows that he has got a right. And this is the means to contain that idea. Otherwise, two people are sitting in the same room. One is the owner, one is a guest, and you can't tell the difference. The keli, the act, the isolated act that intrudes in the design and the setup of the room. This is the keli that this demonstrates as to what his rights are to this place.
They what? They are these isolated acts.
He demonstrates what the principle of his rights to this place.
Yeah, showing on that they're not really isolated. They are indicative of his overall dominion. down here they're finite, etc., but they're not isolated.
Right, my focus on finite is not that finite, they're finite. These are kelim.
Yeah.
Kelim means it identifies a specific thing. In this identifying a specific thing, this is where the oil comes to full focus. I own this house. Okay, what does that mean?
But that's not through a svara.
Huh?
The decorator, that's through a svara.
You mean if not the owner?
You're right. In other words, this is all coming, you started with explaining...
The svara that we're dealing with is that a person, the Rebbe has given a person the right and ownership of a place. And he has the right, the pisvara, that he can, in that pisechel, that he can do anything he wants in his home. Where is that noted? When he actually goes and moves things around.
So the svara is like the middah is within the sefer?
Nobody must say. No, the svara is the initial statement. You can own a home. By divine by mandate, you can own a home. What does that mean? You can be in this world, I can also be in this world. Everybody can be in this world. Everybody who is God's creation can be in this world.
What was the point of bringing in the decorator? That's to show that it's not the same thing, it's totally different?
So the
contrast?
The contrast between the owner moving things around and the decorator moving things around. I think I confused the issue.
It's not coming out this far, by the...
No, this body is that there's such thing as ownership. That is what. This is a supreme swara. This is a seichel swara. It exists only in seichel. It does not exist in anyplace else. The final element of this seichel, the final element of this seichel is that this is God's creation. And God is the one who created all the people in this world. That's why there is this mandate for the human being to maneuver the world around us and God. As a partner to this statement, there is also the concept of total ownership. I'm saying, everybody can be in the world. The owner of the house and not the owner. But there is a principle of ownership. This is the svara that distinguishes one from the other. Again, at the svara level, you don't see the difference
between
the owner and a guest or just a passerby.
Because everyone can own.
Anyone can be here. Where do you see the difference? Where do you see the principle that this is an owner? Not just another person that the Rebbe gave the right to be in the world. For that you need kelim. A means to demonstrate.
what's the connection between Abishah gave everybody the right to be the owner, the right to be in the world, and ownership, total ownership? In other words, there's two different
very things. Different things. This is what you're trying to say. There is ownership and there is the right to be. At the initial level, you can't see the difference. So I say, no, but he owns it. So what? How do you sense, how do you grasp the idea of ownership?
Through a specific act.
Right. This is what's called a keli.
The right to be is also a svara?
The right to be is also a svara. But, okay, you need keli for that, that's a separate thing. But here he say, ownership, well, it's an elusive thing, it's a seichel thing. Where do you see the reality of this ownership? When it is demonstrated, when it is put into a keli, what is a keli for ownership? I can maneuver things, kitzoyne, like that's what's on your mother. That he can move things around like this is his own place. This moving around, though it is minor, this captures and demonstrates the depth of this of the swara of ownership. It's called oyer bikei.
So here, where Hillel or Shammai understands it in a way of.
At that level, there is a clear distinction between how Gili understands it and how Shammai understands it.
How
Hillel and Shammai.
In the Sfara level, it's not Chassid Gevurah Mamash.
That's right. All right, we have to interrupt. We have made our feet here. Put our feet into the water. All right.